I've got a message that he has joined. You know, that's the only thing in a virtual this thing. Ganil Sharma, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. That's what if you switch on your camera. Namaste. Yeah.
Namaste, sir.
Yeah, welcome. And I think we'll start. Pooja, are we ready?
Yes, ma'am. Amulya.
Yeah, sure.
Namaste, everyone. I'm Anandita.
And I am Madhumita.
A hearty welcome to everyone present here.
Our topic for today's performance is Unsung Heroes. We will be presenting a tribute to all unsung heroes and heroines today.
Let's start off the day by invoking the Almighty. We have Sri Shita to recite the prayer.
She hasn't joined us. We can have the recorded version also.
It's a recorded version only. Amulya is presenting it.
Ajam nirvikalpam nirakaramekam nirānandam ānandam advaitapūrṇam परम निर्गुणं निर्विशेषं निरीहं परब्रह्मरूपं गणेशं भजेमा या कुंडेन्दु तुषार हारद वला या शुभ्र वस्त्रान्विता या वीणा वरदंड मंडित करा या श्वेत पद्मासना या ब्रह्माच्युत शंकर प्रभुदिभिः देवैः सदा पूजितान् सामान् पातु सरस्वती भगवती निःशेष जात्यापहा शरीरं स्वरूपं तत्त्वाकलत्रम् यशिश्चारुचित्रं धनं मेरुतुल्यं मनश्चेन लग्नं गुरुरङ्घ्रिपद्मे ततः किं ततः किं ततः किं ततः किम् ततः किं ततः किं ततः किं ततः किम्
थैंक यू श्रीश्रिता for reciting the prayer so melodiously. It has calmed us all. Every morning brings us new thoughts, new words, new strength, and endless possibilities. So here comes Surya to enlighten us and brighten our morning with the thought for the day.
Sometimes the ones who work the hardest and give the most are the ones quietest about what they have done. I repeat, sometimes the ones who work the hardest and give the most are the ones quietest about what they have done. Thank you.
Thank you, Surya, for those words of wisdom. knowing what is happening around us is very important. Now, we have Kashyap and Sarthak to keep us informed with today's news. Over to you, Kashyap and Sarthak.
Namaste. Today, I'm going to tell the national and international news. National news. India celebrates Kargil Vijay Diwas by lighting 559 lamps to honor the war heroes. International news. Large COVID-related protests hit France, Italy, and Australia due to health pass policy. Over to you, Kashyap.
Good morning, teachers and students.
Class.
Today, I'm going to tell the Ganges news. Sampada is to be held on 27 July. Schools from other countries like Egypt and Afghanistan are also participating in this mega event. Sports news. Sindhu beat the 58th ranked Poli Karappa 21-7, 21-10 in a lopsided opening match of Olympics. IPL resumes in UAE on September 19th with MI to CSK match. Thank you.
Thank you, Kashyap and Sarthak, for briefing us about what's happening around us. Now, let's dive right into today's topic, unsung heroes. Anandita, what comes to your mind when I say unsung heroes?
Well, Madhumita, unsung heroes are the people who do admirable things but receive very little praise. For example, we have farmers. The food we eat every single day is grown by farmers with love and hard work. But when we eat, do we even think of poor farmers who starve so that other people don't have to? And here we are, take food for granted.
Oh, and don't forget the police and the doctors. They're working day and night in this situation, sacrificing their life in an attempt to save us all. Acts like these are what bind us together during difficult times.
Very true. And soldiers as well, boldly risking their own lives at the border to save others. Oh, what bravery and heroism, the hardships they face so that we can stay safe.
Yes, Anandita. It is said that soldiers give their tomorrow to protect our today. As today is Kargil Vijay Diwas, we call upon Srija, Amulya, and Sweta to tell us more.
Kargil Vijay Diwas is celebrated on 26 July. It is celebrated to rekindle the pride of the Indian soldiers who took part in Operation Vijay. The Kargil War was fought for more than 60 days and it ended on 26 July 1999. The day marks the victory of Indian soldiers in recapturing the mountain heights that were occupied by the Pakistani army in July during the Kargil War. Kargil is a town in Kargil district, and it's a joint capital of Union Territory of Ladakh. It is the second largest town in Ladakh after Leh. It is located 20 kilometers to the east of Srinagar and 234 kilometers west of Leh.
भारतीय इतिहास में कारगिल को 1999 की सबसे दुखद घटना के लिए याद किया जाता है। लगभग 2000 पाकिस्तानी आतंकवादियों ने कारगिल क्षेत्र पर कब्जा कर लिया और क्षेत्रों में अस्थाई किलों का निर्माण किया। उनका उद्देश्य भारत से कारगिल का नियंत्रण छीन लेना था। उनके विनाश के लिए भारतीय सेना ने ऑपरेशन फ्लश आउट नामक एक विशाल ऑपरेशन शुरू किया, जिसके बाद वायुसेना का ऑपरेशन विजय शुरू किया गया। वायुसेना ने 3 महीने के दौरान बमबारी करके आतंकवादियों के इलाकों को नष्ट कर दिया और अपने कई बहादुर सैनिकों को खो दिया। युद्ध के दौरान भारत के 527 सैनिक शहीद हुए थे। अंततः भारतीय सैनिक हमारी पवित्र भूमि से पाकिस्तानी आतंकवादियों को खदेड़ने में सफल रहे। आज हम युद्ध में लड़ने वाले प्रत्येक सैनिक को आभार व्यक्त करते हैं।
ప్రతి సంవత్సరం ఈ రోజుని వివిధ పాఠశాలలో మరియు ప్రభుత్వ సంస్థానాలలో జరుపుకుంటారు. మనం కోల్పోయిన హీరోల జ్ఞాపకంగా మన జాతీయ జెండాను ఎగురవేస్తాము. ఈ సందర్భంగా ఉత్సవాలకు తోడ్పడడానికి డాన్స్, పాటలు, వ్యాస రచన వంటి పోటీలు జరుగుతాయి. ఈరోజు కార్గిల్ సెక్టర్ మరియు న్యూఢిల్లీలో కూడా జరుపుకుంటారు. ఇక్కడ భారత ప్రధాని ప్రతి సంవత్సరం ఇండియా గేట్ వద్ద మరియు అమర్ జవాన్ జ్యోతి వద్ద నివాళులర్పిస్తారు. సాయుధ దళాల కృషికి జ్ఞాపకంగా దేశవ్యాప్తంగా ఫంక్షన్లు జరుపుకుంటారు. ఇటువంటి కార్యక్రమాల వెనుక ఉద్దేశం కేవలం త్యాగాన్ని సమర్పించుకోవడమే కాదు, జాతీయ సేవ మరియు త్యాగం యొక్క గత ఉదాహరణల నుండి యువత తరాలను ప్రోత్సహించడం కోసం. మాతృభూమి కోసం తమ ధన మన ప్రాణాలను త్యాగం చేసిన మహానుభావులందరికీ వందనాలు.
Thank you, girls. We now request our principal, Miss Subarna Mehrotra, to introduce our special guest for today, Kargil war hero, Colonel Pankaj Sharma.
Thank you, Anandita, and thank you, everyone. So far, the students who have spoken, but I think we are privileged to have somebody who's been on ground zero to just verify the facts that we read and we study in our history books. And we have with us Colonel Pankaj Sharma, who currently is the Deputy Group Commander of the NCC Group Headquarters at Nainital. He passed out from the Officers Training Academy at Chennai way back in 1993. So an illustrious career spanning over 27 and a half years, which is huge, massive. And when one reads about him, something that strikes and comes to the fore is that he's been a part of five major operations that have taken place in our country since then. And I think he should be extremely proud of himself also that, you know, he's been an integral part of these five. And I'd like to tell the students which these five operations have been. So it was Operation Rhino, which took place in the northeast part of our country when there was trouble. So it was a counter-insurgency operation. Likewise, Operation Rakshak, which was again a counter-insurgency task in Jammu and Kashmir. And today we all are here to pay our tribute to all those soldiers who were a part of Operation Vijay. That is how Kargil Vijay Divas gets its name. And of course, that was the Kargil War, which took place in 1999. And he was a part of it very much. And he also got injured during the enemy shelling. And I think we will get to know more about it when he speaks. Then there was Operation Meghdoot, the highest battlefield in the world, which is the Siachen Glacier. He was a participant there as well. And last but not the least, Operation Parakram, which was the general mobilization ordered for the Indian Army after the attack on our parliament. So we are extremely proud and delighted to have Colonel Pankaj Sharma here. Now, besides being an army officer, of course, he is a graduate from the Indian Institute of Management and Commerce. He is also a cricketer and was a part of the services team in the Ranji Trophy. He has also toured England with the under 19 team, cricket team, with the likes of Venkatpati Raju. So we can see that, you know, we've had a few people coming from the army virtually and physically to campus. And every time I think we just find a fine blend of sports and that determination and that perseverance and that love for the country. And Colonel Pankaj Sharma is also a part of the same group. So we are delighted, Colonel Sharma, to have you with us. And I'm sure that the inputs that you will share today, as you discussed yesterday with me, should go a long way in giving us a different perspective. You know, when we talk about wars in our history book, and especially now, it's quite camouflaged with the Bollywood drama, if I may put it that way. And I think a lot of students do get carried away seeing these movies that probably this is the reality, not realizing that it is far more tougher than what we see on that silver screen. So I'm sure you will give us a different perspective here. And as I said, it is an honor to have someone with you on this momentous occasion. So over to you, Colonel Sharma, and I hope, you know, technically we stay sound to be able to see your presentation as well. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, ma'am. At the outset, ma'am, let me thank the principal, Ms. Suparna Mehrotra, the vice principal, Ms. Sinimol, the class teacher who's responsible for today's assembly, Ms. Pooja Kaur, and basically for giving me this opportunity to speak to the future of tomorrow, that is the students of the Ganges Valley School. At the outset, let me ask you, how's the Josh?
Hi, sir.
Okay. And
what
I would be doing is, it'll be more of an interactive session rather than just, presentation. Yes, my story I'll be saying so that you can hear it. But there will be a few questions for the students. And if possible, they can answer. It will be fine. It will be better because they will be able to understand the situation much better. A little bit on the geography first. The map which I am showing right now is, this is the map of India, or rather of Kashmir. The one which is there in the light yellow, this is the area which is held with us. And the one in the other colors, that is the one, either it is with Pakistan, it is with China, or with, it's a disputed territory. So this is the map I'll be referring to for the entire presentation today. A little now on the history side, if we want to know about any particular event, we should know what was the genesis of the problem. So knowing that is very important. And I'm very sure that all the students over here are quite well versed right now with the Google coming in and they being so tech savvy. So can anyone tell me what is the name of the boundary line between India and Pakistan, which was drawn in 1947?
Sir, can I answer?
Yeah, please.
It was called as line of actual control.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay, for the benefit of everyone, I will just flash the answer. It was the Radcliffe line. Yes, this was the line which was drawn in 1947. I'll come to the line of control, what has been just told. I will come to it. But the Radcliffe line was the one which was drawn in 1947 by the Britishers, where they said ki west of the particular line will be Pakistan and east of it will be India. Okay. Another question. Anybody can tell me that how many wars have been fought between India and Pakistan?
Three.
Anybody else?
Four.
Okay. We call off Vijay, which we are celebrating today, also a war, despite we not crossing the border. But still, it is a war. So therefore, we consider it, Google also says it's four wars. The details have been listed on the screen. I will be sharing this presentation with your principal, ma'am. In case anybody is interested, they can have a copy of it. So don't have to note it down right now. You can just listen and, you know, understand it first. Okay. What are the sequence of events which led to the first war of India and Pakistan in 1948? Anyone?
Partition.
Okay, partition.
Refusal of Srinagar for annexation with Pakistan.
Okay, very good. That's very nice. Actually, what has happened is there were a few sequences which took place. As correctly brought out, Pakistan never accepted that the accession of Kashmir was a valid accession treaty. So that was the genesis of this particular problem. And they kept thinking that because Kashmir was not, or Raja Hari Singh, he did not accede to the Indian government. they said that he should be part of, that is Kashmir should be part of Pakistan, primarily because of the they had a lot of Muslims in that, so therefore they stake claim on it. Can someone briefly go through or tell me something about the Shimla Agreement and why is it so important in the Indo-Pakistan relations? Okay, it's a little difficult question. So let me, show it to you why this Shimla Agreement is so important in all our discussions.
Because it liberated Bangladesh from...
Bangladesh was liberated in 1971. The Shimla Agreement was held in 1972. Well, what somebody had said earlier was the line of control. Now, the line of control comes into play now. The line of control was officially accepted by both the parties in the Shimla Agreement. Prior to this, we were saying that Pakistan-occupied Kashmir was our territory and it should be given back to us. But however, in the Shimla Agreement, it was agreed that the line of control is a valid line, and west of it, Pakistan would continue to stay, and east of it, we would be there. So if you are seeing the map, approximately 2/3 of the portion is being controlled by India and 1/3 is with either Pakistan or with China. Now, the other thing which was there is that this line was demarcated until something called an NJ9842. I'd like to explain to you what NJ9842 is. NJ is the name of the map sheet number, which that particular point is available on. And 9842 is the square in which this particular point exists. So therefore, this word NJ9842. So the line was demarcated, or the LC was demarcated until NJ9842, beyond which it was ambiguous. They had said that up to NJ9842 and the line beyond. So what was beyond was left up to the imagination of anyone. So India said that 9842 and beyond means northwards, that is the blue arrow, whereas Pakistan claimed that it is NJ9842 and eastwards towards Karakoram. So that is what is the bone of contention, because of which we have three different borders with the Pakistan. The first one is the international border, which is up to Jammu. Then we have something called the line of control. And in the glaciated sector, that is the Siachen Glacier, we have something called the actual ground position line. Now let's get on to the topic of today, Op Vijay. So the information which has been given by all of you, that is Shrija, Amulya, Shweta, all of them has been well researched, well coordinated. And I should say that both Madhumita and Anandita, both of them have done an excellent job in the comparing. So this is the kind of platform which children require nowadays to, speak out, so that they are more confident in the world when they are going outside. My compliments to all of you. Okay, getting on to the topic, whatever information which has been given to you through the Google or through your history books, it is absolutely correct. I don't dispute that. But there are some things which are not available on history books or are not written, primarily because these are little contentious issues. So I'll give you an insight into that particular thing today. There was an unwritten pact between Pakistan and India that the winter, the posts which were at a height, and they had a lot of snow cover in it during winters, maybe around 12 to 15 feet also. They would be vacated during winters, primarily because stocking them up would be very difficult, because during winters, you cannot walk in that particular area with 15 feet of snow. So you can't replenish them. So therefore, what would happen is we would vacate those posts. This was an unwritten rule. General Musharraf, at that time, when in 1988, he was a brigadier. And he conceptualized this particular plan of using a mix of regulars and some rangers who would get onto these posts during winter. occupy them, modify them to have defenses against the Indian forces, and then obstruct the National Highway 1 Alpha. I'll be telling you what NH 1 Alpha is a little later. And that would, you know, block the supply chain to Leh, thereby alienating Leh from the entire Srinagar Valley. This was his plan in 1988 when he was a brigadier. Now, NH 1 Alpha, for those of you who are not aware, is the national highway which is linking Srinagar with Leh through Dras, Kaksar, and Kargil. Now, I will be showing you some photographs after this, where you can see how close this NH 1 Alpha is from the posts which were occupied by the Kashmiri, by the Pakistanis. Right now, the thing is that NH 1 Alpha is the only source of supplies to Leh. Other than that, you've got Manali route, but that generally is going through little higher passes. Therefore, it is very difficult to go on that particular route. So this is the general area where you have this Op Vijay taking place. Now, the battle which was fought in Op Vijay was in the sectors. As a chief, he executed this particular plan. And the Bakarwals, when they had come to the posts in Kaksar, they had informed the battalion over there that, okay, you go and see on top, you find these Pakistanis are already sitting over there. Whereas, until last year, nobody used to be there because the post used to be vacated. So the CO in Kaksar, he must have sent out a recce patrol on 4th of May. And Captain Saurabh Kalia was the first one to have gone for this patrol. He was captured, tortured, and he was killed. This was the advent of the Op Vijay. For your information, the battle was fought in the sectors of Mashko, Dras, Kaksar, Kargil, Chor Batla, Batalik, and the Sychin Glacier sectors. What we have to understand is, as it was correctly brought out by Shrija as well as Amulya, that on 26th July, we were able to repel the attack of the, these militia. But what you have to understand is, not only was it a military victory, it was a diplomatic victory as well, primarily because we had not violated the Shimla Agreement and we had not crossed over the border. So the international community also was on our side. So that is a very, very important aspect which has to be understood. These photographs are the photographs where I was located in Kargil. So if you see the kind of destruction which was there because of the enemy shelling during Op Vijay. So you can see the, op shelters over there, which were in total destruction. In Kargil, my unit had moved into Kargil in 1998. And at that particular time, Kargil, when we tried to see it on the map, we couldn't make out where Kargil is, and we had to actually search a lot to find out where we were. So now Kargil is a name which is known to everyone. But at that time, we didn't have this particular thing. Our unit was equipped with 130mm guns. The gun which you saw prior to this was a 155 Bofors gun. This one is the 130mm gun. And in February of 1999, I volunteered to go into the Sychin Glacier. So after attending a 3 weeks training in the Sychin Glacier, Sychin Battlefield, this is the highest battle training school in the world. So I got inducted onto a post in Central Glacier. I won't be able to name the post basically because of the security reasons. I had to climb for around 23 days from the base camp to reach this particular post. And you can see the details of the post in on the screen. But can anyone tell me what is the height of Mount Everest?
8,848 meters.
Correct. You're absolutely right. So that is the height of Mount Everest. So I was at somewhere around 6,040 meters or maybe 20,280 feet. Hyderabad, for your information, is at 582 meters or 1,788 feet. Okay. And the dimensions of the posts have been written as 12 meters by 7 meters. Well, it's difficult to comprehend what this dimension is, but just to make it into your perspective, a garage in which your vehicle is parked, a little bigger than that is 12 meters by 7 meters. So that was the space of this post we had. And we were two officers and seven jawans who were staying on this particular post. And I was there on this post for 97 days. Other than that, you know, you should remember this temperature of minus 40 to minus 65 degrees. You can't really comprehend this again because such kind of temperatures are not, you know, you've not been used to it. But you should understand an ice cream remains frozen at minus 10 in your freezer. So I was at minus 40, or not me, most of us were at minus 40. So this is a photograph of Dras where it shows the temperature minus 60 recorded. This is a photograph of my post, which was, you know, you can see it was just a very, very small thing. Everything crammed up inside. Now, when we talk about the distance of the nearest enemy post, what you have to understand is that when the Pakistanis used to be cooking food and their pressure cooker used to, you know, whistle, I could actually hear it from my post and I used to know what they are cooking. So that was the kind of distance which we are talking about, where we are actually eye to eye with the enemy. So on the post, we had no light. There was no generator. There was no electricity. So we had to rely on something called either a solar lantern, or we used to have these bottles of, you know, rum bottles where we filled kerosene, put a wick on top of the, you know, cap and lit it. So this was the only way we could survive on this particular post. We had light for some time. So, you know, the only mode of, you know, time pass over there was either listening to radio, speaking to each other, or writing letters. So in a span of 97 days on the post, I had written more than 550 letters. So most of you will think ki pata nahi kitna vela time hai iske paas ki he can write so many letters. Okay. The rations, the kerosene, the letters, etc., all used to come from the base camp and we had to carry them on our back. The base, which was there below, you can see a photograph of it. From there, we had to lug the entire thing on our back. So we were not allowed more than 220 kgs per person on our back. And we had to cross 33 ladders, numerous crevasses, and climb a 400 meters ice wall, which was at an inclination of 80 degrees. So this particular photograph, if you see, I am doing training in the Siachen Battle School on a 45 degrees wall. Whereas in the post, we had to climb an 80 degree wall with 20 kgs on our back. This is as far as our training and the other things. Now coming to what I actually faced on that eventful day, which is etched into my memory, because that was something which was a life-changing moment for me. So I'll narrate that particular fact. On 20th June 99, when I was on the post, I had executed something called a fire plan, which in which we had shelled a Pakistani gun position, which was approximately three kilometers away from where I was located on the post. So from the intelligence, we came to know that a lot of damage had been caused onto that enemy post, and a lot of casualties had taken place, and this fire plan was very successful. So on 23rd June, when we were sitting down and we were relaxing, that time, that this is at approximately 12:30, the Pakistanis retaliated and resorted to indiscriminate firing. They went all guns off. So I was taking a shoot from the OP bunker, and my technical assistant, Lance Naik Dixit, he was in the MMG bunker. So we were directing fire. And at around 3 o'clock in the afternoon, a rocket propelled grenade of Pakistan, it came and landed onto this mouth of the MMG bunker and it exploded over there. Dixit died instantly and we couldn't actually resuscitate him or something because he was totally ripped apart. I was injured. I had a splinter in my thigh and we had to actually run away from there and we had no place to go because you are aware the size of the post was just 12 by 7. So we had to get into something on the post called an ice cave. A photo of this ice cave is being shown to you. So we went into the ice cave, hid over there till the shelling stopped. And after that, we moved down to the company base. That is a small section of us. We moved down to the section base, the company base. The walk, which generally used to take around 10 minutes, that day it took us around 40 minutes because I was injured and I was bleeding. I was not even having any first aid kind of thing on the post. So we moved there. Once I reached the company base, there was a doctor over there. Every company base generally has a medical team. So the military doctor, he treated me. But what you have to understand is even at the company base, because of its proximity from the enemy, there is no light. So in the darkness, I was operated upon. There were no painkillers over there because we are not geared up for major operations over there. So the splinter in me was removed. Now, a photograph of a splinter is shown to you. There are three splinters over there with a AK-47, bullet. So you can make out what is the size of a splinter. So a splinter was removed from my body. And from there, I was told that I'll have to walk down to the base where the helicopter could come and pick me up. Now, this base is, as I've already told you earlier, 5.5 hours away. But that day, it took me 7 hours in the night where we had to again cross those 33 the ladders and this thing, all with an injured foot. I had 7 stitches in my leg. But there was no way I could have been lifted and evacuated, so I had to walk back. Now, once we came down to the base camp on 24th morning, that is a time when my X-ray was done because there was electricity at the base camp. Then it was confirmed that I had a splinter still there in my body. So I had to move back to Command Hospital, Chandigarh for further treatment. Now, what you have to understand is I was at a place which was minus 40 and the temperature in Chandigarh was around 43 degrees. So the temperature range was, the gap was around 80 degrees difference from there to here. So I was in a real, real bad situation and the pain was different. The weather was worse. So after 11 days of treatment, I was asked and I volunteered to go back to my unit to Kargil. And once I went there, you have to understand, Op Vijay was still on. It was not over. So I went back there and I was inducted as an OP officer into the Batalik sector. So this was the story in short of my that particular eventful day. Now, I would like to just talk about the problems which we face over there. Any soldier who is in the frozen heights, what problems he generally has. Children now will generally, associate problems with normal problems which they face in a day-to-day life. Ki aaj mera Wi-Fi jo hai nahi chal raha hai. Ya because of the lockdown, Zomato is not delivering pizzas. Or India mein PUBG ban ho gaya hai. This is the kind of problems which you face right now. But in the frozen frontiers, we are not only battling against the enemy, but we are battling against the weather. And the problems which we have is listed. Just for your information, those two words which you see, HACO and HAPO, I don't think so you'll be aware of these. HACO is basically high altitude cerebral edema, where water gets into your brain. And HAPO is high altitude pulmonary edema, where water gets into your lungs. So these are the things. Rest, all of them are self-explanatory. I'll be explaining them with the help of photographs. Now, to brave the cold, this is the kind of equipment, the clothing which we get on the base camp. If you notice, the color of the dress is white because it has to gel with the snow. This is the photograph of one of the Indian posts. This is how we have to, you know, climb the ladders or, you know, use the ladders to bridge the gaps between crevasses. This is an avalanche. You can watch some documentaries on the frozen frontier on Discovery or Google. You can see this, how we survive over there and what is our training which we get. This is a photograph of my OP party going onto the post. It is movement from our base one to the post. But what you have to understand is once it starts snowing, the tracks get obliterated. So the snow gets fully covered. So we are waist deep into snow. We don't know where the track is. And we have to devise our own track to reach the post. So this is one of the major problems. If you see this, I don't know whether this particular slide is clear. You can see a track mark which has been highlighted with these arrows. This is the track of the snow scooter. Now the snow scooter used to get the in the dead of the night, it used to get the supplies to this particular base, and it used to dump it there and go back. We used to go around 5.5 hours walk down there, pick up this particular supplies and get it back to our post. This is how we used to maintain ourselves. The enemy got to know about this, and they used to resort to shelling. So those pockmarks which you are seeing on the snow, these are the arty shelling at the Adam base. One problem which I have not highlighted over here, it is basically that only, as I told you earlier, the means of communication was only through post. So I had a sad incident where my grandfather passed away, and I was not informed. I came to know only after 22 days when I got a letter because of the delay of the transportation. So this is the kind of here nowadays you just pick up the phone and you're in communication instantly. At that time, these were the problems. Some snapshots for you to see. The person who has been circled in red is Lance Naik Dixit, whom we lost on the post. Okay, now some fun facts about the glaciated area of the frozen areas of Kargil. As I told you that there was no light, and we had to burn these wicks so that we are having any kind of light. So if you see the kitchen, it is totally black. It's the soot from the burning of kerosene. So the hygiene was the last thing on our mind. And the dress which we were wearing earlier, which was pristine white, has turned into this color, this shade of gray or black. And utensils also, you can see, your mother will not permit you to have food from this kind of a kitchen. If you see this particular place, this is where we used to stay. This is 6 feet by 6 feet and a height of 4 feet. And two officers used to stay in this. And I've stayed in this particular igloo for approximately 97 days. So that is the kind of thing which is very difficult to imagine. If you see that, the children, when they play, they have these toys, they have this kind of a tent, a play tent. So they enjoy the playing with it. So we used to also have that same kind of feeling, because you can't stand up on this. I'm sitting down and still I'm not able to get into the igloo. That is the kind of compactness it has. You've all heard of this poem called Jack and Jill Went Up the Hill. So we used to do that every day. So the snow, we never used to go and fetch water. We used to go and fetch snow, which we used to melt and use the water for all our daily purposes, including, you know, cooking and washing our face. This was the worst part of the day, you know, with that minus 40 degrees and you had to go for your morning job. So the toilets are in the open. There are no covered toilets. But the only solace we had was that entire crap was going, flowing into Pakistan. So that was the only solace we had. Now, when we are in that particular area, rarefied atmosphere, and also we had, you know, lack of oxygen. So we required this kind of rations to be supplied to us to give us a total energy, instant energy. But we actually couldn't eat all this primarily because we never felt like it. So most of this used to, you know, come under our bed, and we used to be sleeping on this. So you can actually say we were sleeping on a bed of chocolates. So this is something, a dream for all of you. Then, you know, it's a very small thing that having a fruity for you, you just take a fruity, you put the straw in it and you have it. But it was a proper procedure at the post when, you know, the fruity is frozen because it's minus 40. So nothing remains solid. So all your experiments of converting solids to liquids and liquids back to solids was being done by us every day there. So we used to put this fruity in boiling water. It used to melt. Then we used to get it back to room temperature and then we used to have it. So it was not so easy. So that is something which you have to understand. Then the last point, that not having taken a bath for 122 days, you know, despite being so dirty over there, we couldn't because the weather was such. Firstly, we didn't have water. We had just to ration water for our drinking. Moreover, we couldn't shave primarily because our skin was so sensitive that when we were shaving, we didn't know whether we are, you know, shaving our beard or we were shaving off our skin. So therefore, we were not permitted to shave at all. Now, these are the, you know, things which are very peculiar to that place. So I have finished my talk. All I wanted to say was that being associated with the NCC and having traveled to many schools and colleges, met many students, they keep asking me, how can we be patriotic? Or how can we serve the nation? What I have to say to them always, and to you also, is that never have to bother about serving the nation in a particular way or joining the uniformed forces. It is not essential. If you are a student right now and you are studying honestly with dedication, you are doing your bit. If you do not litter, if you do not jump a red light while driving a two-wheeler, if you follow the rules, if you conserve natural resources like water and electricity, if you plant a tree, you are doing your bit and you are showing your patriotism and you are showing that you are a useful citizen. So have strong ethics, do the right thing when nobody is observing you. That's very important. The teacher, when she's observing you, it's very easy for you to do things right. But when nobody is observing you, you must do the right thing. That is ethics. And be successful in all your future endeavors. Jai Hind. I have finished. If anybody has any questions, I'm ready to take on.
Sir Pankaj, sir, this is Pooja. First of all, I got all the goosebumps seeing all these things, what you just now said. We take all the things very lightly when we are here and we don't understand what are the pains and the things that all the soldiers and all the people who are, it's just like a, behind the cameras. you're the directors and the people behind the cameras who are doing all the things, and we are safe and sound because of you people. So thank you very much. And this is what I would like all the children to understand, respect and be grateful to what you have. That is the thing, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Your words have made us feel extremely proud and patriotic. I'm sure we have all found it educational and inspiring.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Salute to you and all the war heroes.
Any questions now, by anyone? Wait. There's students from 10th, 11th, 12th. Does anyone have any question to ask?
Ma'am, there are some questions in the chat box.
Okay.
There's one student who has asked, is there a limit to sending any letters? Well, there was no limit as such. It was as to how many letters you could, or how much stationery you could carry on your back and how much you could write and send it back. So it was all on your back. So it depends on how much you can carry. Then there was another question from Nanda who said that, can we know which regiment you were in? Yes, I was in 286 Medium Regiment. This is a declassified information. There is a for quite some time there was a Bofors 130mm gun in the Indira Gandhi Airport. This was the gun from my battery. Even the photograph which I showed of 130mm, that was my battery gun which I had shown the photograph of. Then there's another question from Taruni. He asks, sir, how did you imagine the military life before joining? Honestly speaking, I had absolutely no idea. Though my father was in the military, he was in the Ordnance Corps, but he retired even before I was born. So I didn't know anything about the army life, and everything is a revolution once you go there. So as you once you join class 11th and 12th, you really don't know what you are in for. So you take the things in the stride and you enjoy doing things the way, you know, it comes. Another thing is, didn't ink freeze in those temperatures? Well, we never had an ink point. So we used to use the ballpoint.
Ballpoints.
Sir, just another question. You said, you were trained to, climb those things at 45 degrees.
Yes, ma'am.
Inclination, but when you actually went, it was around 80 degrees or whatever. So, didn't people have an idea of what it is, and why were you not trained more rigorously to meet that?
Okay, ma'am. The photograph which I showed was of a 45 degree ice wall, which is the basic place where we are taught how to climb the ice wall. After this, it's a 3 weeks training. What we were taught was the first week. Then this is something called a two-point contact, climbing. After this, we are taught something called a three-point contact and a four-point contact in the advanced training in the second and third weeks. So we are taught to climb a 90-degree wall and also 120-degree wall. So where it's the inclination is on the other side. So you are actually, trying to climb with your head behind.
No.
Done that also.
Yeah.
I was amazed. Even a small prick, we tend to take rest and with, the shell in your body, and you walked for so long. I mean, do you just get the energy because we have to survive? I just can't imagine being here and never face such a situation, and so will it be for many others. So I really do not know how you get that. But salute, sir. Salute to everybody.
Amulya has asked the same question, how do you keep going through all this? It's not something that you do it for yourself. It's primarily that in case you are not walking, then there are four people who are who have to carry you. So can you put those four people's life at hand while crossing these ladders and those crevasses you are crossing? It's very difficult to do it yourself. So if you are supposed to carry someone, it's even more difficult. So we had to carry Lance Nayak Dixit because he was no more. But when I was alive, I had to walk and I had to endure it, not for my sake. It was for their sake. Then somebody has asked, can you explain the color of the badges you have worn? Well, Rutika, for the benefit of everyone, these are the medals which you get for serving in various operations. As you are aware, your principal ma'am has, you know, when she introduced me, she told about I took part in Op Rhino, I took part in Op Vijay, I took part in, you know, various operations, Op Parakram. So all these medals depict a particular operation or a particular sector in which I have survived. And the most important one is the one which is on the top right for you, left for you, right for me. This is the wound medal which I have received for being injured in war. These are the kind of badges. So there's another question that, sir, who were you close to in the army? Well, there is nobody whom we are close to. It is a, you know, a camaraderie amongst all of us. When I was on the post, I had only one more officer and seven more men with me. So we were close to each of us. When we got posted to another location, we kept in touch with them. Right now you have WhatsApp, right now you have the social media where you can keep in touch. Most of the people whom I was on the post with, I'm not in touch with, because they keep getting posted from one place to another. So I'll say ki, you know, we are in touch when we are together. After that, if we meet ever, like I met my coursemates after maybe around 25 years or 30 years, and this camaraderie which we share, it continues without being physically in touch with each other. So therefore, we are not close to anyone. We are close to everyone. Then there was another question from Divya. She says, how do you react when you see the lawless persons on the street? actually, I am a very impatient person and I let it off. So there are many instances where my daughter, my wife, they say, okay, I should relax. And I try my level best. But the only way we can actually do things is we inculcate the sense of, you know, civic sense in amongst us, which is very essential for the children right now. Because if we are disciplined ourselves, and as I said, if our ethics are good and we do not need somebody to guide us to do the correct thing and do it on our own, that is something which will actually shape the country. So that is most important. And that is what I teach during my NCC camps, when I'm interacting with the cadets, that is what I teach during NCC. There was another question that, was it hard to adapt to normal life after retirement from your action-packed life? Well, actually, I'm not retired as yet. I'm still serving. So another 3 years to go. I may be able to answer your question after that. another question from Karthik. He says, sir, will the gun be given to all the soldiers on the field? Yes, everybody has to carry a gun. Primarily, it's there's a difference between a gun and a rifle. A rifle is a personal weapon. Gun is what in the photograph which I showed you, that is a gun which is weighs around 3,000 to 4,000 kgs. That is a gun. So what every soldier carries is a, you know, 3.5 kgs rifle. So that is his personal weapon. So everybody gets a rifle, not the gun. Gun is only 6 in a battery. Okay. There was another from Suhas. Sir, what do the stars on your shoulder symbolize? Okay. Everybody has, in the army, we have a rank structure. The smallest rank of our officers is a lieutenant, which is 2 stars. Then you graduate to a captain, 3 stars. Then you have a major. You've seen Amitabh Bachchan wearing that Ashoka Stamp. Then you have a lieutenant colonel with an Ashoka Stamp and a star. I'm a colonel, so I have got an Ashoka Stamp with 2 stars. Similarly, now you have a chief of defense staff also. He's got his different rank badges. So these badges symbolize your rank. Then how did you tell your family and friends that you were joining the military? Well, it was my father's dream, and actually I lived up to that particular dream. So I didn't have to tell my father. He only said you must join. He challenged me rather, and I accepted his challenge and I joined. So that is how it was. So how many times were you allowed to meet your family? Well, from the war zone, we don't meet our family. And you will be very surprised that I had got married in 1998. And this happened in 99. After 98, 19th of October, I had left my wife with my parents at home. The next call I had with my wife was on 24th of June, 99, where I was able to just tell her that I was injured, but the phone lines went dead after that, and the phone lines got restored after 3 days. So you can imagine the plight of that young girl who didn't know anything about the army, and she was, my husband is injured and I don't know how he is. So that was the kind of thing. So you are not allowed to meet your family from the post. So once we got down from the post and I went to Chandigarh, she came to meet me there. And after the war finished, and after I was able to get some leave in November, I went, picked her up. The GOC was magnanimous enough to have allowed the families to come to Kargil for 14 days for celebrating the Millennium New Year. That is how you see my wife's photographs on all those places where the we had our op vijay. Describe the moment you felt after coming back from battle. Well, you really can't say what it was and how it was. Even we don't get emotional at that time, at that age. We really what they show in the movies is very different. So that we are singing songs and all that, that doesn't happen. You are normal human beings, you behave normally.
Very true. I think the Q&A session can just go on and on, and you kind of, given that right trigger for the children, as Pooja ma'am said, that we are all so comfortable where we are that it's so difficult to even visualize the kind of challenges that our soldiers face, not only at this frontier. I mean, if I have another session with you where you could explain the Northeast, it's absolutely a different setting altogether. You move to the deserts of Rajasthan, which of course, since my husband comes from the Armored Corps, I know he spent more than 80% of life in the desert of Rajasthan. So there are different scenarios. And of course, people who know the naval aspect of our armored forces, the challenges when you are in cities like Bombay, Calcutta, go to Trivandrum and Vijayawada, there's a different scenario. And the sky is, of course, very different for the Air Force. But yes, I proudly say I have spent 55 years in the Indian Army through my father, through my brother-in-law and my cousins, and of course, later my husband. So I very proudly tell even a person like you, Mr. Colonel Sharma, that you spent 27 and a half years in the army, I've spent 55. And I can truly, truly relate that what a feeling it must have been for your wife not knowing for those 3 days must have been like 30 years for her. Those kind of feelings, yes, one has experienced. I think sometime I have shared with the Ganges students also that during the Kargil war, my husband was near the Jammu border and sitting in a place called Akhnoor, we could hear the shots being fired every night. And that happened to be the year when the World Cup was being held. And we knew that India defeated Pakistan in one of those cricket matches. And that day we knew it would be heavy shelling. And sure enough, that night probably just lit up the skies on the Akhnoor border. So yes, there are these memories one has since, my husband was there for a very, very long time. But that's what men who are in the armed forces are made up of. You all are made of a different kind altogether. Wo Hindi mein kehte hain na, alag hi mitti ke bane hote hain. And that's what Indian soldiers are all about. made from a different metal altogether. And you've really, you know, the way you've narrated the entire thing, it's given us goosebumps. In spite of being in the army for 55 years, every time we hear a story like this, I still feel, you know, that yes, there is something much more than what we know. Hats off to you, hats off to your entire team, your regiment, your battery, and of course, the Indian Army in totality. We are safe, we are sound, we are smiling, we are doing something very different just because you all are guarding our frontiers. So I know students may have many, many other questions, then probably we get you around sometime very soon around Independence Day or something like that. And I'm sure we can have another session with you also. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for being with us. I thought you said your mother would want to be a part of this session. Was she able to join us?
I'm not very sure. Yes, okay. I can confirm. Yes, she was.
I'm sure. Proud mother, proud parents, proud wife, and your daughter must be extremely proud of you as well. Thank you. Thank you so much for being with us here. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, let us see how our friends interpret our theme for today, Unsung Heroes.
There are two kinds of heroes. Heroes who shine in the face of great adversity, who perform amazing feats in difficult situations, and heroes who live among us, who do their work unnoticed by many, but make a difference in the lives of others. They are not the type of people historians recall. They are the builders of communities, the backbone of every town. They are the women and men who work hard and live honestly.
Every day, an unsung hero is born. Someone willing to work tirelessly to benefit the greater good. These unsung heroes do not want medals, glory, or fame. Most would walk away afterwards without anyone ever knowing their name.
They feel that they have not done anything special or something someone else would not have done. Thus, songs of their feats remain forever unsung. To all such heroes, this one is just for you, for all the lives that you make better each day.
Beautifully expressed, my friends. Anandita, don't you think a poem would be such a nice addition to our performance today?
Agreed, Madhumita.
Great. Now, we have Anandita to recite a poem.
For people doing it tough, they do feel sympathy. So blessed are they who possess empathy for how others feel. They do genuinely care, but sad to say, the sort has ever seemed rare. To the higher self, they do live as true, and credit to them in abundance is due. In their words, they never do put others down, the quiet achievers of their side of the town. The people who perform good deeds every day, to help others out, they go out of their way. They help out the people of help who are in need. The town's unsung heroes are heroes indeed. A credit to their communities, by good example they lead. Yet so little of them we do hear of or read. This is a beautiful poem by Frances Duggan.
Thank you, Anandita. That was a remarkable poem.
On behalf of all Gangians, we would like to thank all unsung heroes for their sacrifice and bravery. Without them, India wouldn't be what it is today. Here's a small video by our whole class to show our gratitude and thankfulness.
Thank you. Now, I call upon Nitish and Tanmay for the pledge and national anthem.
India is my country, and all Indians are my brothers and sisters. I love my country, and I am proud of its rich and varied heritage. I shall always strive to be worthy of it. I shall give respect to my parents, teachers, and all elders, and treat everyone with courtesy. To my country and my people, I pledge my devotion. In their well-being and prosperity alone lies my happiness. Jai Hind.
We request everyone to rise for the national anthem.
That was nice on the guitar. That was really nice. Good. A class of musicians, I think, in this 110C.
Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity, ma'am, Suparna ma'am, and getting and making our matlab bolte na jisko char chand laga dena for our assembly. I think everybody should be jealous of us because we got somebody who nobody would be getting. I don't know, but thank you very much, sir. Again, thank you, Suparna ma'am, for the opportunity our children got to hear them. Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you, Kanil Sharma. Thank you so much. And hope to see you soon. Yeah, around here sometime. Thank you.
So, before I end, abhi to story baki hai. So we will meet again on 30th July once more. Pankaj Sharma, sir, wants to join us for the meet. He's most welcome to do that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.